Christmas Eve, December 24th, 2016. This is our candlelight service.
Oh, come let us on the top of the Today's Reading insert in your bulletin. Let us pray. Almighty God, you made this holy night shine with the brightness of the true light. Grant that here on earth we may walk in the light of Jesus' presence, and in the last day wake to the brightness of his glory. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated as we light the Christ candle while singing Infant Holy, Infant Lovely, hymn number 276, followed by the reading of God.
Thanks be to God.
was Tenuel Quirinius, who was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged, and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child, and she gave birth to her firstborn son, and wrapped him in bands of cloth, and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flocks by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly, there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom he favors." When the angel had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go down to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen as it had been told them. The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. Just one announcement to share with you. A reminder, there is one service tomorrow at 10 o'clock. And then the following Sunday, January 1st, New Year's Day, there will also be one service at 10 o'clock. So with tomorrow and New Year's Day being holidays, only one service at 10 both Sundays. Now I ask that you give your attention. peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. What is your reaction to Christmas? For some of us, this is our 65th Christmas or more. For others of us, it's only our 20-something Christmas. And still others, it's only our 5th or 6th Christmas. For those who are under 15, their reaction is probably different than those of us older than 15. And the question is that reaction still one of hope, one of faith, one of trust, and one of belief? Or is your reaction one of boredom, of aggravation? Because once again, you maxed out your credit card, you drained your bank account, you spent all that time decorating, and before you know it, all that work is for nothing as the new year rolls around, the decorations are put away, and the charge bills come rolling in through the mail. Well, this evening, we want to examine what the real reaction of Christmas should be for those of us in the community of faith, and also should be the reaction we want to share with the world that has not yet become part of this community of faith. And in order to understand that reaction, we go back to the shepherds. And as we read our gospel for the celebration of Christmas, we read in that 20th verse, "And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen as it had been told them." The first thing, or the first reaction, that we should have once encountering the baby Jesus, once we encounter the love of God expressed in sending that baby to earth in order to grow into a man, to be our Savior, to pay the debt of sin that we owe, to assure us of forgiveness and the promise of everlasting life. After that reaction, we should not just stand there in awe. We should not withdraw into some mountain and just meditate the rest of our life. But as a shepherd, we should return to our normal behavior. The word translated as return means to go back to where you were. You notice the shepherds, after they saw the baby Jesus, they didn't hang around and keep hanging around and thinking that they could just stay there forever. They went back to work. They went back to watching over the sheep that they had been watching when the angel announced that there was this wonderful event for them to go see in Bethlehem. But sometimes when we have some type of religious experience, we want to stay there and just marvel and meditate. Recall the last week, the beginning of the last week of Jesus' earthly life. Before his triumphal entry on that Sunday of Holy Week, he goes up onto a mountaintop with Peter, James, and John. While they were on that mountain, suddenly Elijah and Moses appear. And Peter, James, and John watch as Jesus has a conversation with Moses and Elijah. And then they disappear, a cloud comes over, and they hear God's voice say, "This is my Son, the Beloved, with whom I am well pleased." And Peter, always the first to react, always the one to make a comment, to make a statement, jumps up and asks Jesus if he should build three booths, that is shelters, so that they can stay there and continue to meditate on that wonderful event. But what does Jesus do? He takes them back down the mountain to be among the people. And that is what we are to do as our first reaction to Christmas, is that once we experience the babe of Bethlehem, once we see God's great love for us and coming down to us in human form, we return to our normal life. For those of us who are still working, we go back to our job and wanted to share that wonderful experience with our coworkers. For those of us who are retired, for those of us who are at home, share with them how much God loves us. Now, sometimes it's not easy to go back to what you were doing when you experienced something unusual. All the time we read about these winners of these giant lottery pots when it gets up to hundreds of millions of dollars. They'll interview them, oh, I'm just going back to work on Monday and just go about my normal life. And then a month later we hear how they have quit their job and disappeared because after they won that lottery, they suddenly discovered they had 100 relatives they never knew about. Nobody ever told about all these relatives suddenly knocking on their door. Or somebody may suddenly suffer a reverse in their health. And so because of that reverse, they cannot continue their job, and so they have to take early retirement. Or someone may be involved in a situation so tragic and so horrible that they just can't go back to their job, as sometimes happens with first responders, that they will be in something so horrible they have to find a new career, or they just can't deal with that kind of tragedy anymore. But going to the manger, going to celebrate Christmas once again, after the celebration, we return to our normal activities in order to share the good news of the gospel. Now, sometimes after a religious experience, some of you may be called to change your lives. We see all the time more and more people who have been involved in a vocation or a profession for 20 years, 10 years, 30 years. God suddenly calls them to go off and be a missionary or be an evangelist, or to enter seminary and become a parish pastor, even at the age of 70 or 80. But for most of us, our first reaction to the Christmas event is to go back to what we were doing. Next, from this event, we should develop a new attitude. And the shepherds returned glorifying and praising God. Now, as many of you know, at the time of Jesus' birth, shepherds were not very well thought of. Shepherds were considered to be outcasts. Shepherds were considered to be people to despise, all because they couldn't satisfy all the rules and regulations and rituals of Judaism. Because they were out in the fields day and night, because they would travel from pasture to pasture, they couldn't abide all the cleanliness laws and dietary laws and clothing laws and everything else. And so constantly they heard from the rabbis in the synagogue and from the Pharisees and the Sadducees how terrible they were. So for the shepherd, this developed in them an idea that God hated them, or at least didn't like them very much. And that God was a judgmental God, who spent all this time just waiting for you to step out of line so he could zap you and put an end to you. But now that the shepherds, these despised people, are the first to go to see the newborn king, their attitude changes. That word glorify means to esteem or to honor God. Before they went to see the baby, they didn't have this esteem and honor for God, because they felt God was a judge, and that God didn't like it. It's the same danger we face in the church when the message from the church, instead of being that we are saved by grace through faith, that God has done everything for our salvation, all we have to do is believe it and accept it, that we can't do anything to save ourselves, which lifts that burden off of us. Instead of that, too often people hear from the church a message of condemnation. A picture of Jesus being a judge who is constantly judging you because of how you dress, or the music you listen to, or the dances you do, or what you do for a living, or how you live, or whatever. And a message of grace is replaced by the old hellfire and judgment. And so instead of seeing Jesus of the gospel, the Jesus of now, the Good Shepherd, the Son of God who loves us so much, he willingly dies on that cross to pay the debt of sin that we on the third day so that we might have victory over sin, death, and the power of the devil. Instead of that message, they get this message of Jesus of the book of Revelation. This return of Jesus. When Jesus will come, and as we confess in the creed, to judge the living and the dead. But we don't know when that's going to happen. So that's not the message to be preached in. The message is the good news that the shepherds heard that first Christmas. So that there should be a new attitude. The reaction to Christmas should be a new attitude first towards God. As you understand that God loves you, that God's not concerned about the things that society criticizes you for, or that some misguided preachers criticize you for. God loves you because He created you, He made you, and He wants you to be with Him for all eternity. He doesn't want you to be a robot who just loves Him because He created you without a free will, and so you have no other choice but to love Him. No, He created us with free will. He wanted a people who would love Him in a response to the love He first shows us through the baby of Bethlehem, through that first Christmas. So our reaction should be that of honoring and esteeming God and knowing that our big brother Jesus Christ is always with us. And that instead of always trying to take the speck out of our neighbor's eye, we need to be concerned about the log that is in our own. So the reaction to Christmas should be a new attitude. And not just a new attitude towards God, but a new attitude towards one another. As the shepherds left that manger, that stable, that first Christmas, they left now understanding that God loved them too. And therefore they were as good as the Pharisees, the Sadducees, and the rabbis in the synagogue. That they weren't any less of. And so that changed their attitude towards the religious elite, toward one another, toward the people they interacted with. Just like our attitude should be changed to understand when Jesus said to love our neighbor as ourselves and to love one another as He loves us. So we have that new attitude that changes everything. We glorify God. We show love and concern for one another. We are not despicable. We are not outcasts. But we are children of the Heavenly Father. And then from that new attitude, from that then comes a new motivation. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen as it had been told. The word heard means to understand something. They now understand that message of the angels, just like we understand it, that Jesus Christ, born of the Virgin Mary, in that place in a manger, the feeding trough for animals, in that stable, because there was no room in the inn, that Jesus is our Savior. He is our way in truth and life. He is our way into the kingdom of all eternity. We don't have to do anything. We have no dietary laws. We have no cleanliness laws that we have to obey. We have no dress codes that we have to follow. Instead, we simply put our trust in that baby born in Bethlehem who grew into a man, who on that first Good Friday willingly went to the cross to suffer and die so that we might have forgiveness and salvation. So now, that should cause us to have a new motivation. And the word seen means to experience. So they experience the love of God from seeing a baby. We experience the love of God through our relationship with Jesus Christ, through the hearing of the word, through receiving the body and blood of Christ in the sacrament of the altar. These are all experiences that help fortify our faith, that enable us to experience Jesus among us and motivates us to change our lives and to be like a little Christ unto our neighbor. So the reaction is a new attitude which brings about a new motivation. And we see this effect in Jesus. Just a couple of examples. Peter, who I mentioned before. Peter is always shooting his mouth off. Peter is always acting like he was the big tough guy. Peter was always the champion of the disciples. So on the night of Jesus' betrayal, when Jesus says everybody's going to leave him, of course, old Peter stood up and said, "Not me, Lord. I'll even die for you." Nothing. These guys, they're all wincing and all run away. Not me. I'm like Hercules. I'm big and bad. Nobody will want to mess with me. So what happens? Peter follows Jesus into the courtyard of the high priest. Some little lady comes up to him and says, "Aren't you one of this guy's followers?" They're in there questioning. Peter almost has a nervous breakdown trying to spit out the words, "Not me, I don't know that guy, never heard him, never seen him." Somebody else comes up to him, "Yeah, you've got to be one of his followers. You've got one of those Galilean accents. Hey, everybody from Galilee doesn't follow him. It's not me." And then confronted again, he denied the third time, the cock crowed again. Or Peter went out and left him. Well, after Jesus' resurrection, we have that beautiful story in the 21st chapter of the Gospel of John, where they're out fishing and they see somebody on the beach and a fire going, and they come closer and they recognize it's Jesus. And after Jesus feeds them breakfast, he tells Peter, "Come with me, Peter, let's go for a walk." And they're walking along the beach away from the other apostles who are still eating. And Jesus says, "Peter, do you love me?" And Peter says, "Yes, Lord, you know I love you." And Jesus says, "Feed my sheep." They go a little bit further. And again, Jesus says, "Peter, do you love me?" Peter says, "Yes, Lord, you know I love you." He says, "Feed my sheep." A third time, as they walk further away from the rest of the group, Jesus again says, "Peter, do you love me?" And now Peter breaks down. And weeping says, "Yes, Lord, you know I love." Jesus says, "Feed my lambs." And with that, he reinstates Peter as a leader of the early church, as a leader of the apostles, and the leader of the church as it begins to spread throughout Jerusalem and Judea and Galilee. Becomes the head of that early church. Another example of the change in attitude or motivation. There was a young man who was born in North Africa in a city called Hippo. His mother was a devout Christian, prayed for him every day to become a follower of Jesus Christ, but he just wanted to live life to the fullest. He was more interested in chasing women and drinking and studying philosophy and being involved in rhetoric as public speaking with others, trying to see who could be the most impressive speaker. And one day he happened to go into a church, and the bishop of Milan, a man by the name of Ambrose, was preaching, and it struck the young man the heart, and he became not just the follower of Jesus, but the second greatest theologian in the history of the church, second only to St. Paul. And of course, I'm talking about St. Augustine, Bishop of Hippo. And then there was a young man who grew up in England, and his father was a sailor, and he became a sailor, and then a captain of a slave ship, and was following the wild life until he had a religious experience during a storm, became an Anglican priest of the Church of England, what we call here in America the Episcopal Church. He also became a hymn writer, wrote many famous hymns that we sing in our hymn book, but his most famous is "Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound," John Newton. Those people's motives for life, motivation for life, were changed because of the baby in Bethlehem. Their reaction to that baby in Bethlehem was to change their life's motivation. And that is what we are to do. When we gather for Christmas, it should not be gathering as one who is bored or aggravated, or saying, well, the same old, we'll go to church, we'll sing the same hymns, the preacher will talk about the little baby and have nobody would give him room in the inn, and then we'll light candles and sing Silent Night, and we'll all go home and Christmas is over for another year. No. Christmas comes on the verge of the beginning of a new calendar year, coming to remind us that as we gather at this table, we gather to be recharged for the upcoming new year so that we may go back to our places, so that we may have that new attitude, and so that we may have that new motivation, motivated to do what God wants us to do, and not what the world wants us to do. To be motivated by that love of God shown to us through that baby in Bethlehem as he grew into a man and became our Savior through his death and resurrection. To allow him to guide us through this new 2017 with that attitude of the shepherds. That should be our reaction to Christmas. Amen. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. We will now sing the first verse of What Child Is This? As our confession of faith. As those who came without difficulty will release them. cannot thank those who came without difficulty to please stand. Let us pray. God of all creation, all you have made is good and your love endures forever. You bring forth bread from the earth and fruit from the vine. Nourish us with these gifts that we might be for the world signs of your gracious presence. In Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. St. John practices an open communion for all those who are baptized and believe in Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. We believe his body and blood are fully present as we gather at his table. In our community age and our own individual congregation, you're invited and encouraged to come forward with us this night as we gather at the table of our Lord. We continue our celebration with a great thanksgiving on page 152 in the front of your worship.
Thank you.
precious blood strengthen and preserve your true faith unto life eternal.
Amen.
Let us pray. O God, we give you thanks that you have set before us this feast, the body and blood of your Son. By your Spirit, strengthen us to serve all in need, and to give ourselves away as bread for the hungry, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. People who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwell in a land of deep darkness, on them has light shined. Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon. For behold, darkness shall cover the earth, and thick darkness the peoples. But the Lord will arise upon you, and his glory will be seen upon you. And nations shall come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your rising. Let us pray. God, our Heavenly Father, you call to our remembrance the birthday of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Receive us, give us grace to keep the festival with pure faith and holy love, that while we join our voices with theirs who sang, Glory to God in the highest, we may not forget to spread abroad the gospel of your peace and goodwill to all the world, through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen. Let us now sing Sabbath.
Amen.
We conclude Joy to the World, hymn number 267.
This concludes our New Year's Christmas Eve service. Tomorrow morning we will have a 10 a.m. service, just one. And then also next week on New Year's Day we will have a 10 a.m. service. St. John's is located. It's 27 North Lewittenburg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508. Merry Christmas.